A very good evening, everyone, and a warm welcome to this semester's iteration of the Voice Discovery Series, brought to you by us, the Voice Literature students. Today, we will be talking about the evolution and history of English vocal music from the time of Henry Purcell to Benjamin Britten. We will be touching on the life and works of these two composers, of course, but we will also uncover some of the lesser known music in the time between them. During the course of this presentation, feel free to leave comments and questions in the chat, and we will have some time at the end to answer questions and perhaps discuss the topic a little further. And with that, we now have Siwei to begin our presentation with Purcell.
Thank you, Daniel. We begin our presentation with Henry Purcell. Henry Purcell was the most important English composer in the Baroque era. He lived through the Restoration, in which the return of Charles II revived musical life dramatically after music was suppressed for nearly two decades by the Commonwealth. Henry Purcell was born in 1659 in London and died in 1695 at the age of 36. He came from a family of musicians and began as a chorister in the Chapel Royal. He became the composer of the King's String Orchestra and in 1679 was appointed as an organist of Westminster Abbey. Later in 1682, he became one of the three organists of the Chapel Royal. He composed a wide range of music in his lifetime: anthems, hymns and sacred pieces, operas, masques, semi-operas, incidental music, ode, welcome songs, and occasional vocal works, catches, and etc. They were heard and performed in church, on the stage, in the court, and even in private settings as entertainment. His contemporary were Matthew Locke, who was Purcell's family friend, Henry Cook, John Blow, who was Purcell's teacher. Let's listen to an anthem called "Blow Up the Trumpet in Zion," performed by the Oxford Camerata. John Blow taught Purcell traditional counterpoint, which benefited his music throughout his career. We can see Blow's influence in this piece as a starting point of Purcell's career. It is richly polyphonic and has text painting on the word trumpet, where the sound of a trumpet is imitated. Purcell's music covers a broad spectrum of forms and modes. Other than the church music which we've just heard, now we are going to look at his stage music. Henry Purcell was most remembered for his only opera, Dido and Aeneas. Let's listen to a little duet of this opera called "Fear No Danger to Ensue," sung here by Emma Kirkby and Julian Baird.
Fear no danger to ensue, the hero knows as well as you. Fear no danger to ensue, the hero knows.
Despite the popularity of his masterpiece Dido and Aeneas, much of Purcell's best work is found within the constraints of the semi-opera format, which contains isolated scenes and masks within the structure of a spoken play. The main characters only speak, and minor characters only sing or dance. Purcell wrote some famous semi-operas, such as The Fairy Queen, Diocletian, King Arthur. Now, let's listen to an aria from King Arthur called What Power Art Thou, performed by David Greco. It is the froth scene in which the cold genius ascends from the frozen ground on a rising chromatic line. This aria was extremely chromatic for Purcell's time, and it laid the foundation for chromaticism later on. Other than church music and stage music, Purcell also wrote court music in commemoration and celebration of a particular event, object, or person. The next piece we are going to listen to is The Sparrow and the Gentle Dove from an ode called From Hardy Climbs and Dangerous Toils of War, also known as Ode for the Wedding of Prince George of Denmark and Princess Anne. The use of ground bass is very common in the Baroque era, and Purcell widely used it in his non-sacred music. Listen out for the ground bass in this piece. This recording is performed by Mark Dobell and the 16 Orchestra.
Happy hour, each hour.
other than pleasing the royals, Purcell also did contribute to social merrymaking. Catch singing was a popular social activity in 17th century England. Catch is a musical composition for two or more voices in perpetual canon. The singing of catches was part of men's entertainment, and the topics are largely confined to drinking, politics, and varying. Also, the words in most of the catches are grossly indecent and often contain misogynistic views of women. Indecency in this form of music did not stop the finest composer of that time from composing a large number of catches. Now, we are going to listen to a catch by Purcell called True Englishmen Drink a Good Health, performed by the 16.
True Englishmen drink a good health to the mitre. Let our church ever flourish, though her enemies spite her. May the carnage and forces no longer prevail, but the malice as well as the arguments fight. Then remember the sinners support of our might, as stout as our martyrs and as just as our lords. Then remember the sinners support of the might, but our church as a flourish.
Now, I will hand it over to Cindy.
Thank you, Sihui. Unfortunately, after Purcell died in 1695, rarely anything worthy of note had been produced by someone born in England. In 1904, the German music critic Oscar Schmitz wrote a book titled Das Land ohne Musik, or The Land Without Music, observing that the classical music canon doesn't include any English composers from roughly 1700 to 1900. But this cliché is not historically accurate. There is plenty of evidence that the British performed and enjoyed good music all through the Baron period of the late 18th to early 19th century. However, they relied on overseas composers to bring music to them. Notable examples are Mozart, Haydn, Mendelssohn, and Handel. Mozart visited England when he was still a child and most certainly composed his first three symphonies in London. Haydn made two highly successful visits, and several of his best-known symphonies were composed wholly or in part when doing so. Felix Mendelssohn made 10 visits to England and Scotland between 1829 and 1847, and some of his best-known works were inspired by his visits. His oratorio, Elijah, was commissioned by a Birmingham music festival and received its premiere in Birmingham Town Hall. His performances were always well received, even by Queen Victoria. Let us listen to Lift Thine Eyes from Elijah, sung by the choir of Canterbury Cathedral.
Thank you.
Handel spent most of his career in England and eventually became a citizen in 1727. When Handel first arrived in London in 1712, oratorio was still an unknown musical genre there. An oratorio is a musical piece that is usually lengthy and based on some biblical or religious event. It is a performance for voice and orchestra, but the story is told through the music and not with scenery, costumes, and action. Handel gradually developed an entirely unique English variant, skillfully combining elements taken from Italian opera and oratorio, the English anthem, and other sources. The end result was so different from contemporary oratorio on the continent that it has to be considered on its own, which made him virtually the father of English oratorio. Let's watch Handel's famous Hallelujah chorus from his oratorio Messiah, sung by the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. Foreign-born composers influenced English music extensively, initiating stylistic trends that shouldn't be excluded from the English musical style. To a listener from the 18th or 19th century, a Handelian oratorio would definitely sound more English than German. There were several English composers who wrote music in the 18th and 19th centuries, including William Boyce, Samuel Sebastian Wesley, and John Steiner, just to name a few. Although, most of them produced religious music, which was unfortunately ignored by the classical music canon. Religious music thrived in England, contributing to the English musical style development during this period. Let us watch Samuel Wesley's hymn, Lead Me, Lord, sung by the Cathedral of Our Lady of the Angels Choir. Another form of music that flourished during this time was glee. Glee is an English type of part song or choral music spanning the late Baroque, classical, and early Romantic periods. It is usually scored for at least three voices and generally intended to be sung unaccompanied. Glees often consist of a number of short, musically contrasted movements, and their text can be about anything. Their respectable and artistic character contrasts with the humor of the many catches of the late 17th century, which was thought inappropriate in female company. Glee, together with the catch or round, made up the greater part of the repertory of the English clubs once prominent in English musical life. Glee singing societies became popular in the 18th century and remained so well into the 19th century. A notable example of a glee is Glorious Apollo, a composition by Samuel Webb, written in 1787 as a theme song for the newly founded London Glee Club. Let's watch the Apollo Male Chorus singing Glorious Apollo. I'm going to hand it over to Yong Eun, who will elaborate more on the music on this period.
Thank you, Cindy. Besides music for glee clubs, church, and concert halls, music for the home also began to flourish. As the Victorian era dawned in England, so did the rise of the drawing room ballad. Now, perhaps when we think of a Victorian drawing room, we see something like this. In many similar paintings of the era, we notice two things. One, that pianos were very popular in households, and two, that it is very often a woman playing it and not a man. But why is that? Let's start with the pianos. A new mechanism for the upright piano was introduced in 1826 by Robert Warnham, a London piano maker. This new patent, coupled with industrialization, meant that more and more middle-class households could include pianos as a staple for home entertainment. Moreover, the possession of a piano, and the implication that one could play it, was a sort of status symbol among the middle class. Music as a hobby was generally encouraged, meshing perfectly with the Victorian belief in rational amusement, that leisure activities should lead to self-improvement. This was seen as particularly true for girls, and music became essential to girls' boarding school curriculums. As English cleric of the time wrote, playing piano makes a girl sit upright, previous please, sit upright and pay attention to details. Music as a profession, however, was not encouraged to women or to anyone really, and so it was only considered charming for a woman to play music if she did so privately. Ironically, this relegation of women to private spheres of music making did lead to a rise in female composers. The invention of the upright piano and its wholesale introduction into middle-class drawing rooms from about 1830 onwards must be seen as a very important factor in the high output of piano music and songs that were composed by women. It's a quote from Derek Hyde's book. Next slide, please. Ballads were solo songs with piano accompaniments to be performed for private entertainment. Thematically, these were usually quite overtly sentimental songs. Common topics included morals, children, patriotism, friendship, and the grim realization that one has been jilted in love. On that note, let's listen to O Mother, Take the Wheel Away, with words and music by Charlotte Ailington Bernard, an English poet and composer who wrote many ballads and hymns under the pen name Claribel. Being a married woman, such protection was necessary in a profession deemed unfit for ladies. In this song, a young girl tells her mother she is too sad to spin at the spinning wheel tonight because the boy who was courting her is marrying someone else. Recalling some of the common ballad themes listed earlier, this song is exemplary of those, as well as being an excellent example of how the acceptability of women composing drawing room music provided a platform for female narratives, where many canonical art songs discuss love from the perspective of the man in the heterosexual relationship. This rendition was sung by soprano Helen MacArthur and taken from the album The Vintage Melodies, Songs of the Victorian Era.
Bells tonight, his wedding bells they were, and Mabel is his happy wife, and I am lonely here. A year ago tonight, I mind, he sought me for his bride, and who so glad at heart as I, that happy
here, the melody is made up of short two-bar phrases with cadences following the rhyme scheme of the poem. The piano part doesn't quite rival the difficulty of other contemporary canonical art songs. In other words, it's simple to learn, memorize, execute, and enjoy, which was all we really needed for drawing room entertainment. I do personally believe that this, however, is what led to the exclusion of Victorian ballads from a canon which prizes complexity as well as adherence to romantic ideals instead of Victorian ideals. But that's music for the home. What about music as a profession? Well, despite the social frowning upon the inclination, conservatories all around Europe were also on the rise. This is a list of conservatories with their founding years, not including what is currently the Royal Northern College of Music and the Royal Birmingham Conservatoire, also founded in this century. Perhaps the sheer number of music institutions cropping up in England at this time may serve as testimony against Schmidt's accusation of a landowner Musik. Next slide, please. Principals of the RAM include some of the composers that Cindy mentioned earlier, Cipriani Potter and William Sterndale Bennett. Notable alumni include Michael Head, Arthur Sullivan of Gilbert and Sullivan, and one of my favorite English art song composers, Elton John. The real English composer factory, though, was the Royal College of Music, headed by George Grove and then Hubert Parry. We see here potential for the argument that the RCM supported a resurgence of English musical output. Parry was a proponent of the English musical renaissance, which sought to break away from foreign influence to develop an English musical aesthetic. Here is Parry's O Mistress Mine from his second set of English lyrics, published in 1886, No, the title of this collection makes a point of the material's English heritage. This familiar Shakespearean text was famously set by English Renaissance composer Thomas Morley, and much later also Gerald Finzi and Roger Quilter. This recording was performed by tenor James Gilchrist and pianist Andrew West, taken from volume 1 out of 3 of their 12 sets of English lyrics.
Oh, mistress mine, where are you roaming? Oh, stay and hear your true love's coming, that can sing both high and low. Trip no further, pretty sweeting. Journey's end in lovers' meeting, every wise man's son doth know. Present mirth hath present laughter. What's to come is still unsure. In delay there lies no plenty. Then come kiss me, sweet and 20. Youth's a staff will not end.
The RCN churned out the likes of Vaughan Williams, Samuel Coleridge Taylor, Gustav Holst, and of course, Benjamin Britten, the composer we will focus on next. Considering the fame and canonical status of several of these composers, we could argue that the RCN was crucial in the revival of English song culture. Further questioning could consider this alongside the music education of girls in Victorian boarding schools, to examine the role of musical education in shaping English musical identity. For now, Daniel will go into detail on how Benjamin Britten's life and views shaped his music, which ultimately contributed to England's musical landscape.
Thank you, Young'un. We now move to the 20th century, leading us to an essential figure in British music, Benjamin Britten. We cannot discuss British music without considering Britten, who was arguably the 20th century's most prominent British composer. Many things in his life influenced his work, but his childhood, his musical development, the events around him, the people he met, but two salient factors seem to have the greatest influence, and they are the Second World War and his relationship with his partner, Peter Pierce. Britten's output was prolific, and he wrote many works for various instrumentational configurations, but his contributions to the genre of vocal music were particularly noteworthy. He solidified his place as a composer of opera with his opera Peter Grimes, written in 1945, as well as several others, the other 14 that he composed thereafter. His operas had recurring themes of the conflict of an outsider versus an antagonistic society and the tarnishing of innocence. This could be said to be a reflection of the man he was and how he related to society, especially when you consider his identity as a homosexual and a pacifist amid wartime England, which was a period of social and political difficulty. Now, as we mentioned, Britten was a pacifist. Next slide, please. Britten was a pacifist, which is one who finds no justice in war and violence. He developed an anti-war stance well before the outbreak of World War II and involved himself with the Peace Pledge Union in the 1930s. This union was one of Britten's most prominent peace-committed organizations, and it attracted the support of many writers, thinkers, and musicians, including Britten himself. And so commentary on war can be found in several of his pieces. His large-scale war requiem might be the most explicit example of this. In fact, the soloists for the premiere performance of the war requiem were the British tenor Peter Pears, the German baritone Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, and the Russian soprano Galina Vishnevskaya. Their collaboration was intended to represent a reconciliation and the unifying of the opposing nationalities from World War II. Now, that said, the theme of war is also present in his music for solo voice, such as in his Canticle 3, which we shall listen to presently. Now, before that, I shall explain that Britten's Canticles are a set of 5 works for voice and various accompaniments set to religious-inspired texts, hence the name Canticle or a kind of hymn. Canticle 3 is entitled Still Falls the Rain, and it takes its title from its title and text from a poem by Edith Sitwell. The poem was written as an account of the raids on London in 1940 and was published the year after in 1941. It contrasts the self-destructing nature of man with the mercy of God, painting a picture of the agony of London in the Blitz of World War II. And so the rain here is a metaphor for the bombs falling on the city, bringing agony and death. Now we have Peter Pears and Britten at the piano for us to have a listen. Britten's setting of that split the poem into individual verses of vocal recitative with supporting piano accompaniment, interspersed with instrumental episodes of the piano and horn, giving the music a rather declamatory and forbidding quality. Now, in 1945, Britten toured with violinist Yehudi Menuhin, visiting liberated German concentration camps, where they played to the emaciated survivors. Following this visit, Britten produced the song cycle, The Holy Sonnets of John Donne. The horrors that he witnessed, combined with the hopefulness of the survivors, inspired him to set selected sonnets of John Donne, which contained images of death, spiritual crisis, and ultimately a renewed hope after adversity. Now, let's have a listen to the last song in this cycle, Death Be Not Proud, Here, Britten calls on Purcell's favorite device, the ground bass or passacaglia, to make the point of life moving forward after the horrors of war. Again, we have Britten and Pierce to let us have a listen. Speaking about Britten's life and vocal music, it would be remiss not to consider the tenor, Peter Pierce, with whom he shared a symbiotic relationship. The singer played no small part in presenting Britten's work to the public, and he served as Britten's primary muse and collaborator. In fact, much of Britten's vocal writing was written with Pierce's voice in mind, and we are fortunate to be able to hear the recordings they made together. The influence of their relationship on Britten's vocal compositions manifests in his choice of texts and the musical setting of these texts. One could even trace the development of Britten's vocal writing as the musicianship of these two men morphed over the years. The last of Britten's cycles for voice and piano, specifically for the tenor Peter Pierce, was Who Are These Children? Interestingly, the poems were written by William Suter, who was also a pacifist. The text definitely appealed to both men for their commentary of war and its effects on humanity, especially to children. The poems reflect upon the innocence, the loss of innocence, and on the cost of war for both the individual and for society, which no doubt resonated with the composer. Now, let us listen to the eponymous work of the cycle, Who Are These Children?, played and sung once again by Britten and Pierce.
Silver at the throats and on the hunting whips. than this scene within a world at war. Who are these children gathered here out of the fire and smoke that with remembering faces stare upon the foxy folk?
Britten has gained a reputation for his skill in text setting, the handling of the English language in song, and for his ingenuity in connecting poetry to music. His work augments the ideas in the text and allows the listener a deeper view of the ideas presented, a feat achieved only by composers with a genius for song, as Britten was. On top of that, his pacifist beliefs and homosexuality gave him a unique perspective in a crucial time of England's and perhaps the world's history, all amplified through the voice of his partner, Peter Pears. And thus, we can say that Britten's music was at once personal and political. He actively sought to redefine the national British sound through his individual approach to music, and brought English song culture full circle by contributing his realizations of Henry Purcell, which Tin Tiu will now discuss.
Thank you, Daniel. Britten had a lifelong love for the music of Henry Purcell. Next slide, please. Aiming at the revitalization of British music and literature, Benjamin Britten wrote many realizations on Henry Purcell's works. A realization means an actual form given to a concept or work. Britten had filled out many of the missing harmonies and the ground bass lines as the accompaniments left in Purcell's music, which originally intended to be improvised. He gave full artistic life to Purcell's music in the contemporary style. With the help of the tenor Peter Pears, Britten took into consideration how the vocal techniques have changed between the time of the Baroque period, which Purcell had lived through, and the 20th century style, and he synthesized these two approaches together. Britten had composed 56 Purcell's realizations in total, and most of them are for solo voice and piano. Under the help of the British composer Imogen Host, Britten also realized Purcell's complete opera, Dido and Aeneas, and his semi-opera, The Fairy Queen. In Britten's Purcell realizations, he followed the consistency of the format of Purcell's works and only made some subtle changes in his realizations. The song is transformed from simplicity and beauty to complexity and subtle nuance under Britten's hands. Let's take a look at one of Britten's Purcell realization, An Evening Hymn. Henry Purcell composed this piece in 1688 and included this piece in five divine hymns from Harmonia Sacra. Britten finished this realization in 1947. In his realization, the ground bass theme has heard a total of 22 times during the song, and Britten treats it differently each time to get a taste of the improvisation tradition. Britten adheres strictly to the given bass line, altering only the octave in which the pitches are sounded, doublings, and a slight alteration to the rhythm in one bar. In fact, Britten claimed in many of his books that his realizations are not intended to be a definitive edition or a work of reference. It is a performing edition for the contemporary conditions. Besides the ground bass, Britten also changed the harmony subtly in this piece. Britten rarely altering
Britten rarely altered the underlying harmony in his realizations, and only at the moments when the figures might be potentially ambiguous does he take those liberties. In this song, Purcell didn't indicate the opening grand theme, therefore, Britten subtly changed the harmony in the opening five bars and imbued the text with a peaceful rather than a somber inflection. Now, let's listen to the evening hymn of both versions. First, let's listen to Emma Kirkby singing Henry Purcell's An Evening Hymn. And now, let's listen to Benjamin Britten's realization by Ruby Hills. Beyond performing and realizing Purcell's works, Britten was very influenced by Purcell's composition style. He borrowed and adopted some of Purcell's composing ideas and transformed them into his own compositions with his personal understanding. One of the most outstanding composition ideas that Britten has borrowed from Purcell's works is the free and expressive manner of using the English language. Purcell's melodies are all based on the text prosody and the intonation of the English language. He used melismas for appropriate textures to depict the text and express the meanings of the words. He illustrated sounds from the reality with the illustrative melodic figures with a specific meaning. For example, he used the specific tonalities for different moods or themes. Moreover, to fit the melodic lines in the text better, Purcell also used irregular rhythms in his music frequently. This has also shown in Britten's music, especially after his exposure to Purcell's music. Britten's folk song arrangements are another important part of his works. The arranged folk song is like a precious stone, taken by a well-known composer and reset in a new setting, both creating an opportunity to view the well-known gem afresh, but also to create a new piece altogether. The arranged folk song, given new life by the composers of the contemporary repute, is one of the few branches of music that seem to have originated originated in England. Britten's English folk song publication is predated by the ambitious project during the 1780s by George Thomason Endenburg of publishing arrangements of folk songs by the greatest European composers. This was many decades before German and French composers became interested in their own folk music. Thomason recruited no less than Joseph Haydn, Ludwig von Beethoven, Hummel, and Carl Maria von Weber. The British public seemed to enjoy the prestige of these names, and there was an absolute boom in sales and interest in dressing up British folk music in the civilized garb. However, Thomason was completely unconcerned with the authenticity of folk song. If a tune had words attached to it that seems not decent enough, he simply arranged for new ones from the best poets of that time. Cecil Sharp is another important figure in the history of the British folk song movement. He was considered to be the father of the British folk song revival, which was raised in the late 19th century. Cecil Sharp collected over 4,000 folk songs, which he notated each by hand. He published over 1,000 folk melodies and wrote over 500 accompaniments. However, as the British accompanist Graham Johnson wrote in his book, Cecil was no composer and had little dramatic flair. He said his arrangements are dull and the great value of his musicological achievements have been undermined by his untiring worthiness. Australian-born American composer Percy Grainger is another important figure in British folk song collection. A few years after Cecil Sharp's action of collecting folk songs, Percy Grainger came to Britten in 1901. From 1905 to 1909, he used a recording machine to capture the actual voices of his folk singers. Grainger has a huge focus on the authenticity of the folk songs. His folk song transcriptions differ radically from his folk song arrangements. He strove to write down the original song he heard as accurately as possible, and a huge enthusiasm was shown in his meticulously notated transcriptions, often with highly complex meters and rhythmic patterns. Next piece. Benjamin Britten was very inspired by Percy Grainger. With the help of his tenor Peter Pierce, he conducted and recorded Salute to Percy Grainger in the 1970s. Very different from Percy Grainger, Benjamin had a bigger focus on the artistic interpretation and texture painting in his folk song arrangements. In Grainger's version, the accompaniment is more difficult and there is more chromaticism that make his music sound more like a reharmonization arrangement, while Benjamin Britten's version is more simpler and more focused on the drama and the mood of the story in the folk song. Now, let's listen to their different interpretations of the same folk song, Early One Morning. Since the last part of this song is where the melody has its full beauty and complete development, I will only play the last part of Percy Grainger's version for you. Early One Morning, Percy Grainger, by the North Texas Wind Symphony. And now let's listen to Benjamin Britten's arrangement, sung by Felicity Lott. as one of the most influential British composers in history, Britten successfully promoted the development of British music and gave it more possibilities, not only in history, but also in the future. He unearthed the essence of Henry Purcell's music and put his amazing works buried for centuries in the contemporary editions and led more people to appreciate the beauty of early British music. With the foundation established by Henry the British music as he wished.
Thank you, Jane. And now we have reached the Q&A section of our presentation. And I believe our first question is, why, give me a moment. Yes. Why do you think there are so many songs about love? And I think it's not exactly related to music. I think the reason why there's so much art, you know, it doesn't just exist in music, it also exists in literature. And so there's a lot of poetry written about love and that was inspired by love, primarily because I think, you know, love is such an emotional thing. And so it inspires and spurs a lot of creative output. You know, they say that where words fail, music speaks, right? And so the next natural thing to do, I think, after you discover poetry that has to do with love, the next thing to do is then to set it to music. And thankfully we have so many composers that were so skilled in fusing poetry with music that made the masterpieces that we have the fortune to hear today. And so we have a second question. The second question is, how did Purcell's vocal works differ from other composers of this generation?
Yeah, Purcell's vocal work mostly text-driven and was written in a more freer manner. And then where other compositions at that time are rather in a strained tone, and his music is quite experimental in a lot of ways. And in terms of harmony, we can refer to the aria we've just heard, What Power Art Thou? So it's very experimental in terms of the harmony, and it laid the foundation to the chromaticism later on.
Yeah, and so we have a final question. What to you is the most prominent characteristic of British song? What makes it stand apart from German Lieder, French Melody, and other art songs?
I'd like to take this one. I think that's a very interesting question and something I tried really hard to solve in my process of reading for this. I think on a musical level, like sheer like characteristics, I think the folk song movement is what lends a lot of that unique quality, like these very balanced, symmetrical, melodic phrases that are so perfectly suited to the text, right? Folk song is about passing down stories or values through text, and the melody is supposed to help us remember that. So it's so suited to the voice and how it works. It's so like idiomatic to the voice as an instrument. I think that also ties in with the fact that a lot of these songs are therefore so suited to the language they're written in. And I do think that language has an inherent like musical quality that leads music to sound a certain way, even if we can't pinpoint it into specific elements of like rhythm or harmony. But also the examples, for example, the O Mistress Mine or some of the other songs that are set by like Hubert Parry do have very Lieder-ish qualities or things we associate with Lieder, like that introduction and postlude are very much tone painting, setting the mood. A lot of these, like the fermatas or the tonal shifts, when the third verse gets a bit dark and cryptic, it goes into a minor key. All of these things that we associate with Lieder, really, if it's just the melody and we don't have the lyrics, we may not be able to distinguish like a Lieder from an English song, not always. So sometimes the language and the suitability of the song to the language can give an inherent quality. Yeah, and like Ralph Vaughan Williams has that an essay called National Music, where he asserts that music is national and it will have a local quality if it's inspired by things in the composer's surroundings. So like if Britten is inspired by his surroundings or his ancestry in terms of Purcell, then it becomes English in some way. Yeah, I hope that answers the question.
I think I just want to add on to the point you made about how the language, you know, has its inherent music and that contributes to and informs the way the composition is made. And it's funny because that got me thinking about, I think Haydn wrote some songs in English and he's not a native speaker of English, I believe. And so in singing them, you kind of realize that the language is set in kind of a strange, not so natural way. It's not that the text settings were not correct or anything. It's just that, you know, the flow of the language is, and the way it is set, it's not, you know, there's something a bit odd about it. Yeah. So it just goes back to how it goes back to the composer's skill in handling the language and how familiar they are with it. You realize that a lot of the composers we spoke about today were not only native speakers of the language, but they, being native speakers of the language, they therefore had, you know, the best knowledge and how to deal with it and therefore make compositions that are truly effective. Yeah. And I think with that, we've come to the end of our presentation. Thank you so much for joining us this evening to talk about English vocal music. And we hope you had a good time and took away something. And we hope to see you in the next one.
Thank you.
Thank you.